What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to another late night in the Brew Lab with me, Lone Fox, your brewmaster in chief. And tonight in the Brew Lab, I'm coming at you with a freaking epic Esper Legends brew. But before we jump into that, I thought it would be interesting to quickly go over this metagame breakdown for this weekend's World Championship event, because there's a connection here. So, written by Frank Karsten, who you might remember from when I mentioned the mana base, you know, the math that he figured out to how many sources of what color to play in your land based, you know, if you want to cast everything on turn, except you should definitely go read up, go look at his, you know, just Google his name, you'll find his articles, you know, whatever this guy writes, it's usually very spot on as far as Magic is concerned. And he's done the breakdown for the World Championship, so I'm not going to read through the whole thing, just very interesting. I'm definitely going to be watching all of it and trying my best to live stream all of it as well, so we can have a little watch party action going on. I should be staying in an apartment in Parma with really good Wi-Fi, so fingers crossed it should be working just fine. If not, I'll definitely be watching it regardless. And I will also be putting up a video on every day of the World Championship with one of the decks from the World Championships. And they don't give you the decks yet. I think those will be live tomorrow, at some point tomorrow. But they do have the breakdown. So Explorer doesn't really interest my channel particularly, but I am very happy that it is one of the formats of the event. I'm much rather it be Explorer than Historic or Alchemy, and there's plenty of cards that I decks that I just have no idea what's going on in Explorer, and I really can't wait to see how this plays out. It should be really fun. 25% of the field Abzan Greasefang, so maybe Parhelion needs a looking at. But it'll be interesting to see if they can actually take it, because there's some interesting other one-offs here. But yeah, as you know, I don't know much about Explorer. I'm just going to go in as a viewer, and I can't wait to check it out. But as far as the standard metagame, 68.8.2% off of being really, really nice. The deck count is 22 out of the 32. Is Esper midrange with Rafine and Wedding Announcement. This comes obviously shortly after the Meetup Massacre banning. I've been predicting now for a few times on camera that Jund would take it, but that was before the Meetup got banned. Now, I wonder. There's only 4 Jund decks at the whole event, and I can't wait to see how they challenge the, you know, the big dog in the house, because obviously anybody who isn't playing Esper midrange thinks they figured out a way to beat Esper midrange. And again, there's lots of one-offs. I'm probably going to be picking out of these spicy lists for the videos that are coming out over this weekend. Yeah, like, I'm really keen to see what this Mardu midrange is going to do and who's piloting it. Azorius Control might even be, you know, the reigning world champ. He's known for this type of deck. The only Azorius Control mage, like, but yeah, I wonder if my predictions are true and Jund wins it. Or if Esper is just by far and large way too unbeatable, it'll be interesting to see. But yeah, the reason why this ties in with tonight's brew is because, as I said, we're playing Esper Legends. And without further ado, let's jump into tonight's brew. This is a spicy one. I took some ideas from Untapped and did, you know, I've been playing it solidly. This was actually what I was supposed to put up on Monday for Meta Mondays. So I've been playing it quite solidly since then and getting some good wins. And I made, of course, some small brew labifications here and there along the way. So we've got lots of things going on. The synergies are endless. It's a bit tough to wrap your head around all of them, but they're all creatures, right? So you want your creatures to do more than just be a creature. So I've got, of course, Talia is great. Stalling the opponent a little bit, being able to, you know, survive one more turn from a sweeper or what have you can sometimes be the turn you need. So yeah, Talia is obviously great, and all of these are, you know, turn 2, any of these, turn 3, Rafine, Loving Life, turn 2, any of these, turn 3, Adeline, attack, Loving Life. It's all kind of done like that way. That's why there's three of each of these important ones, but there's only, you know, two and one of these, which are kind of spicy. We've got a couple copies of Geralf or Geralf, the Visionary Stitcher. So zombies you control have flying. There's another card that gives a zombie, you know, anthem effect, which is Ratted Rabik of Urborg, probably the main and most important card in the deck. Other zombies you control have vigilance. And whenever a legendary creature you control dies, it returns it to the battlefield as a token that's a copy of that creature, except it's no longer legendary, and it's a zombie in addition to its other types and colors. So whatever comes back with Ratted Rabik will have flying and vigilance. Pretty crazy. And you have a sac outlet. Sometimes you've got this creature on the battlefield that, you know, the opponent's not doing you the courtesy of killing, and you kind of want him to kill it. Like, I don't know, maybe your Urtai or what have you, or, you know, even your Sheldred. You can just pay one blue, tap Geralf, sacrifice it, or maybe, it, you know, they're targeting it. You sacrifice it, and you create an XX blue zombie creature token where X is the sacrificed creature's toughness. So in Sheldred's case, you get a 5/5 flying zombie with vigilance. You know, you can sack one of your own dragons in response to exile removal and get the death triggers off of your AO and your Junji, and then you'd get a, you know, big zombie as well. And you'd get them back if you've got Ratted Rabik in play. You can see where this is going. It's pretty bonkers. And of course, we've got the amazing line of just play Rafine and then play a Sheoldred. And, you know, whenever you're attacking with Rafine and a few other creatures, that because of the connive, you draw three cards, you got Sheoldred down. It's amazing. And it's also great Sheoldred to play against opponent Rafine decks where they don't have their Sheoldred down yet. They now, every time they attack, they're taking six damage on top of, you know, whatever else. It's pretty nice when you look at it that way, and especially considering we're going into an Esper meta now for the next little while until the set drops. Because, well, it depends on Worlds results, but I have a feeling it's gonna, yeah, it could just take it. So, of course, the deck doesn't look quite like this. This is the legendary pile. I don't have wedding announcement and all that other stuff. It's just creatures. We've got Urtai in here to counter some spells, activated abilities, or triggered abilities. We can also destroy target creature or planeswalker with it. We've got a Toulouse, just a sneaky one-off Toulouse, which can help us restock our hand. So whenever you connive, either with your Rafine or with it, whenever you discard a card for that matter, it ends up underneath Toulouse, exiled, and then whenever Toulouse dies, then you get all those exiled cards back to your hand. So a nice little bit of a restock there. Yeah, that's really all I have to say about it. Other than the mana base, you know, the reason for the deck box cover and the name of the deck is, you know, the reason why this even works at all really is Plaza of Heroes. You can spend this mana to cast only legendary spells, which you can tap it to add a mana of any color. So helping a lot alongside Rafine's Tower and all these beautiful deals that we have to cast all of our stuff on curve. And then the main real reason it's in here is you can pay three colorless, tap it, exile it, and then give a target legendary creature hexproof and indestructible until end of turn. You'll know when it's time to hold that up and be ready. The opponent might be just about to hit you with a sweeper or targeted removal spell, whatever. They're almost never ready for it, and you catch them unawares often, more often than not with that. Then we've got two of each of the legendary lands, no problems. Because of all the legendary creatures, we can cast these for next to nothing. They're often just cost you the one blue, the one black, the one white, just to channel these, because of the number of legendaries we have. A full playset of Rafine for the cycle. And then just duels and basics, of course, with my beautiful Godzilla lands where possible. And that is the deck, the Plaza of Legends. Let's jump into some games. See how the deck performs on the mythic ladder. Climb back up into the sort of the mid-90s. The combination of this deck and Mardu Angels Revisited, which we'll probably look at in the next couple of days. Probably on Monday after the World Champs. Nah. Okay, I'll keep it. Whatever. Oh, I got the new thing. The new pet and the new sleeves. I bought myself the packets. I had to splurge. Okay, make this appear. Another make disappear or syncopate. No. Sheesh. Man, I hate this matchup. It's so boring. While they decide whether this is an important counterspell or not. Just throwing everything that you have at them. Maybe something sticks. Woo! The tax from Talia is what I was hoping for. Okay. Doesn't hold up the blocker. Got this blocker. Should we just trade if he goes for it? Free blocker. Got only two cards left in hand. Okay. Counter. Yes, please. I have other ways of making you big, Mr. Jin. Sweet block. Anyway, our Talia comes back. Okay. That's one way of doing it. Whoop-de-doo. That's a pity. I want to keep my AO, thank you. Okay. Nice. It's nothing quite like beating on Mono Blue these days. It's probably my favorite, favorite win in current standard. There's decks I hate playing against more, like, Heartbreaker Horror variants, but this Mono Blue Jhin stuff comes close to being right up there with the most annoying. Hey. Sure. Not again. Yep, again. What have I done? Oh dear Lord. I don't deserve this. I'll take a risk. Because of the Talia, we actually managed to get that on the battlefield. Fading Hook won't work. There it will. It's the only place. That sucks. It keeps one on the top, huh? Also slow. Real slow. Oh, go on then, mate. Really? Makes for some riveting content as well, I know. Just wowza, mind blowing. If you have another Fading Hope, this is when you use it. Otherwise, let me go. Maybe he's having connection problems. I can't believe anybody would think this long about a Raphine 1-4. Yes, you are touching my Raphine. I was debating there whether it would be better to get a Talia back in while we were open. Ridiculous. Annoying deck and you're slow? Come on, mate. You. Dear Lord. This is mental. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Make disappear. No. Cool. Oh yeah, he had. Haha. Then he had two mana. Talia wins again. Opponent. Wow. I could have written an essay on roping. A couple pages long at this point. Two mana, carry the three. Tap one more, discard the thing, okay. No wait. Wow. Connives. Discard. Start making ourselves a fresh hand if they kill Toulouse. Oh, this is mental. Goes under the Toulouse. And we try and land. We play Adeline now. Try and call another counterspell out of his hand. So that, you know, there's a smaller chance that he'll have one next turn when we try and play Radadrabic. Doesn't have the mana for make disappear. Talia, baby, I love you. What, now the djinn? Oh, so haughty. Two mono blue, get stuffed. All right, how are we doing for time? Fantastic. Loving life. On to the next one. Hopefully something that isn't mono blue. I, for one, am sick of it. I am sure you guys are too at this point. Octopodes. Octopodes. Nice. Octopodes. Keeping his hand. I was trying to decide which is more annoying, this pet or the goblin. With his little giggle. Ah, it's been a, like, this is supposed to be everywhere on the ladder. I don't play against it as often as you'd think. Pardon me. So Sheoldred next turn, unless he hits us with Anointed Peacekeeper. Also pretty terrible though, I must say. Is he gonna enlist? Yes. That's fucking 5 damage right there. No bueno. Gonna have to hope to have this Sheoldred stick. Got destroy evil. Doesn't have it. Okay, if we can, if it sticks and we can play Rafine, suddenly I'm feeling a lot more happy. Maybe we get another land for AO. We're probably only looking at Sarah Paragon here to worry about. You just forget to do that properly. Oh, got it. So I think Jadar, you need to go, my friend. And I'm not risking him having a channel land available. It's highly likely a Ganjo. What's his name? Without a sweeper, this is a terrible matchup. Fingers crossed. Here comes the Ganjo land thing. A jig. Or is he just going to discard something? Okay. Of course. Of course. Of course he had it. Again. I couldn't not block it. Nice. Surprising how little mono white I play against. You guys can just go watch the videos from the last like 4 nights. And it's still considered to be at the top in terms of play pat. I don't know. Weird. Maybe, you know, just goes to show how inaccurate even Untapped is. They don't have the full picture. There's plenty of people that aren't playing with that installed. So. Yes, a pretty big sample size, but not the full sample size. Toki, toki, toki. Turn 3, Rafine. Swing with Denik. One of the best possible situations. Bye. Bye-bye. Didn't even want to stick around. Minutes in. We're looking good so far. Three wins, one loss. Bomez. My name's Bomez. Domain deck. Mana screw. That sucks. We needed that third land there, man. Oh, that makes me really annoyed. As though at least the opponent is having some similar issues, but not quite as bad as us. Jeez. Ridiculous. Land. This is insane. This is completely absurd. 27 lands in the deck. You know, just thought I'd put that out there. 27 lands in the deck. We haven't drawn more than 2 in the top 15 cards of our life. Yay. If I don't draw one next turn, I'll just concede. We can fit in more games. Oh, Allah the freaking Luya. Oh, dear Lord. Curving out like a charm. Everything going just groovy and dandy. Should have drawn with your bank buster then. Another ley line. Oh. Nice. Telling me there's a chance. Flash is in the Wandering Emperor, not has the exile. Oh, deep pop. Cool, cool, cool. Wow, Shuffler's just fine. The little dude to block. No. Clever laddie. You're a clever laddie, aren't ya? Oh, how very interesting, my dear. A little doggy. A little doggy. Aww. Isn't he just the cutest, mate? Isn't he just adorable? Oh. We still have Ur-Tai mana. And then we see, maybe he puts lifelink on something with the Elspeth. Whatever he decides to target, we're going in with the destroy. No! Not Zur! How dare you! Oh, that's terrible. That is way too much life gain. Oh my god, you unbelievable rat. You absolute rat. He's back up on 20. Holy cannoli, mate. Oh, fuck off. Mwah. That was beautiful, Vomez. I applaud you. That was a sick Zur list. Nothing much you can do against that. Holy cow, did he play it at the perfect time? And the amount of life he gained off of all those 7-7s at that point with the wedding announcement. Amazing, amazing. You guys will have to go watch my five color domain Zur pile from a few days ago. It was still one of the best decks we put up on the channel in a while. But that is going to be it. We've arrived at the 45-minute mark. Don't have much else to add. An unfortunate defeat there at the end. I really thought I had him for a second. But otherwise, as you can see, pretty freaking cool deck that doesn't need any interaction. Just plays strong creatures all the way. And wham bam, thank you, ma'am. So, definitely worth your attention. Take it for a spin, see how it performs for you. There's definitely other alternatives. It just being legendary creatures, it could have been plenty of other things in here that I just omitted. This is my version. Also, the mana base, you could probably cut a couple of lands and play a few more legends. I just wanted to make sure to hit our lands this time around because I was having some bricking in testing. So I've gone with much higher than my usual. But it also helps to have just random things to connive away. Sometimes you don't want to connive away the thing that you've gotten, and then it's just better to have a land to discard at that point, etc. That is going to be it for tonight's gameplay footage. I hope you all enjoyed it. As always, those of you who stick around to the end, thank you so much. You are my favorite people in the whole wide world. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, please. I will be seeing you all tomorrow with a World Championship brew. And until then, this is Lone Fox from the Brew Lab, signing out. Peace, y'all.